CNN.
Tonight, a rare live interview with Gordon B. Hinckley, president of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, next on Larry King Live. He's one of the distinguished religious leaders in the world. It's an honor to have him as our guest tonight for the full hour. Later we'll be including your phone calls. He's Gordon Hinckley. Gordon B. Hinckley is president of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, commonly known as the Mormons. He is 88 and a half years old.
Correct.
Do you think, like, maybe retiring?
Oh, no, there's no chance. Gotta keep going right to the end.
You're gonna go till the calling comes.
Right.
What does the president entail? I've heard it, you called a prophet. Are you when you speak, do you speak for the church?
I speak for the church, yes, I think so. Yes.
And this is a position that you're appointed. How do you get this? How do you get to be president?
You're appointed a member of the Council of 12, and you outlive everybody else. Senior member of the 12 becomes the president of the church.
The council takes turns.
Right.
We'll cover some little bit about the faith and then lots of issues. Why are you a Mormon?
Oh, I believe in it. I believe very strongly in it.
Were you born into it?
I come from a Mormon background. I'm the third generation in the church, only the third. From pioneer days, my grandfather came across the plains in a wagon with oxen, and my father was active in the church. I'm here, part of it. As a young man, I went on a mission and came back, and I've moved up through the various steps.
All your life has been in the church?
Yes, because when I came home from my mission, I'd received my bachelor's degree before I went on a mission. That's unusual now, but it was not uncommon then. And when I came back, the heads of the church asked me to come and work there, and I pioneered in the public relations work of the church.
And you're the one taking this church even wider worldwide.
I hope
so.
Past,
right? What's your goal?
My goal is to move it as fast and as solidly across the world as we can.
How many countries are you in?
161.
Time magazine reported that you have the church has over 10 million members worldwide, right?
Yes, sir.
Half in America.
Yes, approximately.
And it's growing outside as well as inside.
Absolutely, yes.
How about the wealth? Why is your church so wealthy?
Because
I mean, at 5.9 billion.
Well, I don't know about that figure, but we get along. We have enough to take care of what we need to do. The financial law of the church is the law of tithing. It goes back to the Old Testament.
They give all the church members...
10% is expected of our people, and they pay it faithfully.
And the money is used how? When people hear that much money and they associate it with religion, they often think of why does a religion... any faith have to raise funds?
We have to build many buildings. As this church grows, we have to accommodate our people. We'll finish or dedicate 600 new buildings this year. That's a tremendous undertaking. We maintain Brigham Young University, the largest private church-sponsored university in America.
That's your school, right? I mean, you own that school.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And we have many other projects, a great family history resource used by people all over the world.
You check the genealogy, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In Israel, they work with
you. If you'd like to know about Larry King Live, we'd probably have a record on you.
I know you have a record on my wife because I married a Mormon, it should be stated.
Well, we have them on not only those in the church, but out of the church as well.
Let's discuss first the president.
Right.
Many religious leaders are now speaking out. In fact, a major church this morning said he should resign. What, President Hinckley, are your thoughts on President Clinton?
Well, I feel very sorry for him in the first place. Here's a man of great talent and capacity who's evidently just hurt himself so seriously that it must be a terrible thing for him. Personally, I forgive him. The Lord has said, I, the Lord, will forgive whom I will forgive. But of you, it's required to forgive all men. And in that sense, I forgive him of any offenses committed against me. But he still has accountability. He's accountable to the Congress. He's accountable to the people of the United States who elected him. He's accountable to God. I believe that. And that's what he must face.
And who determines that accounting?
the Congress of the United States, the House of Representatives, where it will go first. And if they make a judgment there that in the direction of impeachment, then it will go to the Senate.
If the charge, as we've heard it, that just what he admitted to, obviously that part is true, if that's it, there are some saying he should resign, some saying he shouldn't. Do you think he should leave the post if he has morally impaired it?
Well, let me say that I still believe that right is right and wrong is wrong. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. These aren't suggestions. These are commandments.
It was a fait accompli. It was not
negotiated. Given by Jehovah on Sinai, the Ten Commandments. They're as applicable today as they were when they were first given.
Should he then resign, Mr. President?
I think he must make his own decision and the Congress must make their decision.
So when you say you forgive the act?
I forgive
You forgive the actor, not the act.
I forgive the actor, as far as I'm concerned. I'm not trying to hold any malice against him or anybody else. I think that's my responsibility, to extend the hand of forgiveness and helpfulness. But at the same time, the position of President of the United States of America carries with it a tremendous trust, in my judgment, an inescapable trust. I brought with me some words from George Washington, the first inaugural address of 1789. This is what he said. He hoped that the foundations of our national policy will be laid in the pure and immutable principles of private morality, and the preeminence of free government be exemplified by all the attributes which can win the affections of its citizens and command the respect of the world. That's a great statement. Is it asking too much of our public servants to not only make of this nation the greatest nation on earth politically, militarily, but also to give moral leadership to the world?
What do you think it's done to the country?
I think it's fractured the country, for one thing. I see the evidence of that everywhere. As I've listened to your program with various congressmen on, I've said to myself, this is divisive. It's happened, but it's divisive. Let's get the report from Mr. Starr. Let's have the Congress act on it. Let's make a decision. Let's move on.
Are you shocked, as some in the religious field are, that a lot of the public still continues to be in his favor?
Well, I'm surprised. I'm not shocked, I'm surprised. I'm disappointed in a sense, because it's my feeling that you cannot divorce private behavior from public leadership.
Can't divorce it.
I don't believe so.
That includes then your private behavior. If you
My private behavior is
our business.
I have an accountability. I carry a trust that's incumbent upon me. Yes.
We'll be right back with President Gordon B. Hinckley, the president of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Lots of issues to discuss. Your phone calls too. Don't go away. In a major front page story on the Mormons, Time magazine quoted the sociologist Rodney Stark of the University of Washington. He said that in about 82 years, Mormon membership worldwide will be 260 million. What is the attraction?
I won't be around when that prophecy is fulfilled.
But I wouldn't bet on it at 88 and a half. What attracts people to the faith, those not born of it?
I think that several things do. One, we stand for something. We stand solid and strong for something. We don't equivocate. We don't just fuss around over this and that. People are looking for something. In this world of shifting values, of anchors that are slipping, many people are looking for something that they can hold on to, an anchor to which they can attach their lives. That's one thing. Two, we expect things of our people. We expect them to do things. We expect them to measure up to certain standards. It isn't always easy to be a member of this church. It's demanding, but it's wonderfully fruitful and has a tremendous effect upon people.
You require helping people less fortunate, right?
Yes, sir, okay. We do.
Are people ever thrown out of your church?
Yes.
For?
Doing what they shouldn't do, preaching false doctrine, speaking out publicly. They can carry all the opinion they wish within their heads, so to speak. But if they begin to try to persuade others, then they may be called in to a disciplinary council.
All right, now,
we don't excommunicate many, but we do some.
Concerning morality, in the past, the church has had some problems in this area. One was the racial area. The story was that blacks couldn't attain any hierarchy.
Right.
Is that changed?
Yes, it has. In 1978, that was changed. We now work strongly among the blacks. I've been to Africa recently, up and down that continent, meeting with wonderful people, great leaders. All of our local leaders are local people who work on a volunteer basis. None of them is paid.
Could there someday be a black president?
Oh, it could be. It's conceivable, yes.
Just as there could be a black pope someday.
Sure.
So that's all equal.
Yes, all equal.
Now the big story raging in Utah, before we get back to morals and morality, is the big story, if you don't know it, is polygamy in Utah. There's been major charges. The governor, Mike Leavitt, says that there are legal reasons why the state of Utah has not prosecuted alleged polygamists. Leavitt said plural marriage may be protected by the First Amendment. He is the great-great-grandson, is the governor of a polygamist. First, tell me about the church and polygamy. When it started, it allowed it?
When our people came west, they permitted it on a restricted scale.
You could have a certain amount of...
The figures that I have are from between 2% and 5% of our people were involved in it. It was a very limited practice, carefully safeguarded. In 1890, that practice was discontinued. The president of the church, the man who occupied the position which I occupy today, went before the people, said he had prayed about it, worked on it, and had received the Lord a revelation that the time to stop was to discontinue it. Then, that's 118 years ago. It's behind us.
But when the word is mentioned, when you hear the word, you think Mormon, right?
I mean, you do, mistakenly. They have no connection with us, whatever. They're not belong. They don't belong to the church. There are actually no Mormon fundamentalists.
Are you surprised that there's apparently a lot of polygamy in Utah?
Well, I've seen the thing grow somewhat. I don't know how large it is. I don't know how pervasive it is.
Should there be arrests?
It's a matter of civil procedure. Church can't do anything. We have no authority in this matter, none whatever.
Would you like to see the state clamp down on it?
I think that I leave that entirely in the hands of the civil officers. It's a civil offense. It's in violation of the law. We have nothing to do with it. We're totally distanced. And if the state chooses to move on it, that's a responsibility of civil officers.
But President Hinckley, when the press that pays attention to it does affect you, certainly in a public relations sense.
It does, because people mistakenly assume that this church has something to do with it. It has nothing whatever to do with it. It has had nothing to do with it for a very long time. It's outside the realm of our responsibility. These people are not members. Any man or woman who becomes involved in it is excommunicated from the church.
Prosecutors in Utah quoted a saying they told the Salt Lake Tribune, that it's difficult to prosecute polygamists because of a lack of evidence, and ex-wives and daughters rarely complain about it.
Well,
I see that as a problem.
It's secretive. There's a certain element of secretiveness about it. I suppose they have some difficulty, they say they do, in gathering evidence.
Should the church be more forceful in speaking out? I mean, you're forceful here tonight, but maybe in saying that it's rather than just a state matter, encouraging the state to prosecute.
I don't know. We'll consider that.
I'm giving you an idea.
Yeah,
would you look better if you were?
I don't know that we would or not. As far as I'm concerned, I have nothing to do with it. It belongs to the civil officers of the state.
You condemn it.
I condemn it, yes, as a practice, because I think it is not doctrinal. It is not legal. And this church takes the position that we will abide by the law. We believe in being subject to kings, presidents, rulers, magistrates, in honoring, obeying, and sustaining the law.
The essence of the church is that Christ was in the Americas, right?
Yes, at one time.
That is the essence of the concept of the church. And that is the Latter-day Saints?
That's one of the elements of it. Now, that's the background out of which comes the Book of Mormon. The Bible is, as I see it, the testament of the old world. The Book of Mormon is the testament of the new world. And they go hand in hand in testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ.
We'll talk with President Hinckley about the Mormon Church speaking out on great world issues right after this. We're back. This is a historic night. We have the president of the Mormon Church as our special guest, and Mark McGuire has bested the all-time home run record, hitting number 62 tonight in St. Louis. We're with the distinguished Gordon B. Hinckley, president of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I guess you congratulate Mr. McGuire, too.
I do, most heartily.
You've seen a lot of baseball
great
history in your life.
Great celebration.
You were around when Ruth was playing.
I was around when Ruth was playing.
Did you ever see Ruth?
No, I never did.
But you knew
we didn't have television then. But we read about it in the paper. We had a scoreboard on Main Street.
Where? Main Street in
and
Salt Lake?
South Temple, yes.
They
baseball
put up
scoreboard.
The scores.
Yeah. Oh, well, the ball was moved around on the board, and people would stand out there by the hundreds and watch it.
And everyone knew to Babe.
Oh, absolutely.
We've discussed Mike Leavitt, the governor of Utah, and that his difficulty in trying some of these cases. The L.A. Times, New York Times reported widespread reports of girls as young as 10 into arranged marriages and a difficult time dealing with it. Tell us your thoughts about this governor.
Well, the governor is a native of Utah, young man. Part of the economy and the insurance business, other things. Grew up there. I know his father and mother well. I know him well. I regard him as a good man, doing a good job.
Is this a tough spot for him?
It's a tough spot for him. He's dependent on the county attorneys, the prosecuting attorneys. They have to make the decision on this matter.
Why would they be hesitant, do you think?
Well, no. I don't know. I haven't gone into it. I don't know why, but they are. There are many factors, I think. Gathering of evidence is difficult. What do you do with children and their parents? A very difficult situation to face. It's a hard thing to deal with. But as far as we're concerned, it's behind us. Long ways. We're out moving across the world.
There are splinter groups.
Oh, there are splinter groups.
Off your faith, as they have
that.
Off many faiths.
Oh, sure. Oh, sure. We have some splinter groups.
Why does the church, or maybe I'm in error, not speak? Like, I've gone to services, and there's no priest or rabbi or minister, but I have not heard a Sunday service that would discuss world poverty or President Clinton or what they think of Bosnia. Why?
We don't think much about it, but we act. That's what happens. We've carried on a great humanitarian effort.
Feeding people?
Feeding people. Giving them medicine, clothing, food. North Korea, we don't let politics stand in the way of what we do.
You work in North Korea?
Yes, we've just been very helpful there. We've given them a lot of money. We've sent a farmer there, an expert from Canada, to show them how to raise crops.
This is politics aside, then?
Politics aside. The church does not become involved in politics. We don't favor any candidate. We don't permit our buildings to be used for political purposes. We don't favor any party.
But you do speak out, or will speak out more, on moral issues.
We speak very strongly on moral issues. Gambling, liquor, what have you. Yes.
Against them all, right?
That's right.
How about guns?
Guns we haven't done much with. I don't have one.
Neither do I. But are you thinking about maybe speaking out more?
I don't think we've given it any consideration that I remember.
We'll be right back with President Gordon Hinckley. In a little while, we'll go to your phone calls. He is president of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Senator Joseph Lieberman will be here Thursday night. Senator John Ashcroft tomorrow. Don't go away. In Washington, on a fairly regular basis, there are prayer breakfasts.
Right.
Billy Graham is a 10. I'm sure you've been at some. Should we pray for our president?
I think we should pray for our president.
And the prayer should say what?
I don't know. I haven't given that a lot of thought, but it would pray for strength to stand up in these difficult circumstances. He's going through something terrible. His wife must be going through something terrible. His daughter must be going through something terrible. He needs help. Now, I repeat, that doesn't mean that he isn't accountable. He occupies a great and sacred trust. As you know, if a school principal were involved in any such thing as he's accused of being involved in, he wouldn't last a day, scarcely. School teacher, police officer, any of these people, he's the president of the United States. There's a right way, there's a wrong way. There's truth, there's mischief, there's evil. I don't think it's asking too much of any public officer to stand tall and be a model before the people, not only in the ordinary aspects of leadership, but in the way and manner in which he conducts himself.
You use the word mischief. Is this worse than mischief?
Oh, yes,
it
sure.
Is.
That is the thing of which he's accused.
Yeah.
I want to say...
And he admitted to.
Candidly and straightforwardly, that I'm speaking to a principle now.
Right.
And not particularly to a personality. This is a principle concerning the kind of behavior of which he's been accused.
Yet you can love and forgive him.
Oh, I think so.
At the same time condemning the behavior.
I've been in President Clinton's office, in the Oval Office, had a very pleasant, delightful visit with him. About a year or two ago, I don't remember when it was, we gave him his family history.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Traced it back through?
Yes. And had a wonderful visit with him. The man has tremendous ability, tremendous capacity. Now he jeopardizes all of that with this kind of thing. It's just a tragedy.
You knew President Reagan, too, did you not?
Yes. Presented his family history to him.
I thought you'd bring mine tonight. Anyway, we'll be right back with President Gordon B. Hinckley of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints with your phone calls next. Don't go away. Mormons are certainly famous for having children. In fact, I believe one of your hospitals in Salt Lake City is the busiest maternity ward in America.
I don't know.
In that regard, what does this current tribulation with the president say or do to children, do you think?
Oh, I think it has a corrosive influence on everybody. Not everybody. There's some people who just brush it off.
Look the other way.
On many, many people. I think it's damaging to children. They can't watch television without bumping into it. I think it's a difficult thing, and children need help these days. Families need strengthening. That's our great undertaking, one of many, to strengthen the families, to reach out to people. Put father at the head of the house. Again.
In charge?
In charge.
Of the mother?
A good man, a good father.
In charge?
Who loves his wife and whose wife loves him and whose children love him. And let them grow together as good citizens of the land. The great problem facing this nation, in my belief, is what's happening to the American home. It's falling apart. Families are falling apart all over the world.
When you say father in charge, you mean he's the boss of the movement?
Oh, I don't mean that, boss. Look, been a father. You've been a father.
Yep.
Do you run around bossing people?
Nope.
No, of course not. You acted with love and appreciation.
Family
and respect.
Unity, you're talking about.
Family unity.
Why do you think it's gone? Travel,
well,
jet age, movement, television?
People have abdicated their responsibility. Fathers have. I read in the Reader's Digest some years ago an article by a judge in New York who said that his experience indicated that the problem with the families falling apart was that there was no father in that family. Now, here we have children born to husbandless wives, hundreds of thousands of them, 23% of the births in the United States into fatherless homes. With that kind of phenomenon going on, what do you expect?
What do you feel about all the effect of all of this on Chelsea, Clinton?
Well, I can only guess. That's purely speculative, but I think it would be very, very difficult. Very difficult. I think it'd be difficult on any child.
Let's take some calls for President Hinckley. We start with Houston, Texas. Hello.
Yes, a recent news story said that videos of the movie Titanic being sold in Utah were having certain parts edited or censored. What parts are they and why? And do you or the Mormon Church believe in the censorship of books or films?
No, we don't censor books and films. As a practice, no. This thing that's taking place has nothing whatever to do with the church, not a thing.
Do you know what they're taking out?
Yes, I've read just a newspaper story on it. That's all I know about it.
What was taken out?
That they excised a portion in the film that was where there was nudity and things, something of that kind.
But that's not a church thing.
No, it has nothing whatever to do with the church. I should say not.
Tallahassee, Florida. Hello.
Hello, Larry.
Hi.
President, one of the things that I'm asked constantly is why doesn't the church come out many a times when they are accused or attacked in the press and or in the media in general?
We do come out sometimes, but you have to know this, that if you get into a fight with somebody, you just excite more curiosity and create more problems than you settle.
But if stories affect you, like this polygamy story affects you because it's associated with the past of the Mormons.
I've made a statement, I've just made one now. We've made some other statements. It is simply not a church issue.
London, England, hello.
Hi, good morning, Larry.
Hi.
Hi, Mr. Hinckley, I just have a question.
Yes. As
a representative of the Christian faith, I just had a question about if you feel like the president is doing a good job, you know, why can't we just forgive and forget his, you know, human errors and, you know, get on with it? You know, because he is human.
And we're hearing a lot of this. He's human, forgive, and if you forgive, forget.
Your question is well taken. A lot of people feel just as you feel. I just get back to the fact that I would appreciate in our public leaders more of valuing personal probity. If you don't establish values at the top and live by those values, you seriously jeopardize behavior down below in the ranks.
But when you say, as this woman is saying, he's doing a good job, she's a Christian, you're of the Christian faith. I guess you don't call yourself Christians, right?
Of course we do.
You are Christian. Okay. You're of the faith.
Yeah.
The founder of all of Christianity forgave.
Forgive them, for they know not what they do.
And she said, forgive and forget.
I've said exactly that on this program
tonight.
That I forgive him, but he is still accountable to the people who elected him. He's accountable to the Congress who sit in judgment on him. And I believe he's accountable to God.
And do you believe that God calls in his accounts?
Oh, I don't have much doubt of that.
You think we pay the piper?
What is it that Revelation says? And the books were opened. And we were judged out of the books. Sure, I think we have to stand before God and make an accounting of our lives.
We'll be right back.
God expects something of us.
Do you ever doubt your faith?
No.
We'll be right back with President Hinckley on Larry King Live after this. Before we take our next call, apparently there's a lack of clarity in some area, a lot of people calling in. If he asked you, would you recommend resignation or would you say wait till Congress hears it? On a pure personal recommendation basis.
I would say wait till Congress acts on it. He hasn't been convicted of anything. He's made certain admissions, but he has not been convicted of malfeasance in office or any of those things. I would let it take its course.
Do you fear the worst in the Starr report on personal fear?
No, I don't.
You don't?
I don't. I haven't. No, I don't think so.
Because there are a lot of rumors.
There are rumors all over the place. Washington leaks like a sieve.
Louisville, Kentucky with President Hinckley. Hello.
Hello, this is Hugh Elgin, and my question is to Mr. Hinckley. if I just read the Bible, the Old Testament, the New Testament, and preach out of it, is that incomplete? In other words, do I need to read the Book of Mormon and preach it as well? Or can I just get by on the Old and New Testament?
As you read the Bible, you will find the statement, in the mouths of two or more witnesses shall all things be established. That is a biblical statement. The Bible is a witness of the divinity of Christ. The Book of Mormon, we assert, is also a witness of the divinity of Christ. And those two, hand in hand, become two voices speaking in declaration of the divinity of the Lord.
So you should refer to and read from three books.
Two books. Old Testament, New Testament, and the Book of Mormon.
That's three books, right?
Yes.
When someone only preaches the New Testament, are they in error?
Oh, I don't know they're in error. They're going as far as they feel disposed to go.
And the Old Testament as far as they feel disposed
to go.
And you're saying to them, bring your faith with you, right?
Sure.
You're not saying leave your Catholicism.
I say this to other people. You develop all the good you can. We have no animosity toward any other church. We do not oppose other churches. We never speak negatively of other churches. We say to people, you bring all the good that you have, and let us see if we can add to it.
Salt Lake City, Utah. Hello.
Hello. How are you doing, Larry?
I'm fine.
Hey, I was wondering about some of the guidelines and dietary restrictions Mormons live by and how strictly members follow them. Because I was reading once the Word of Wisdom, my impression was that its major point was that one should respect all life, including animals, and such, as such, only consume them when absolutely necessary to sustain life and to then eat them sparingly. But I've noticed that this is rarely followed by Mormons, and I'm wondering if this has something to do with, as reported by Time magazine.
Okay, President?
Oh, I don't know. You've read a part of the Word of Wisdom. The Word of Wisdom covers many things. It covers the excessive use of meat, as I see it. It covers, in a very particular way, the use of tobacco and alcohol.
By saying no?
By proscribing those things.
No to caffeine,
coffee, and tea.
Dietary laws in the Old Testament were based on the health of animals and stuff. Yeah.
Well, the wonderful thing is that the Word of Wisdom has shown to be fruitful in what it the accomplishments
You were ahead of yourself in the health craze.
Yeah. This man I met here not too long ago at UCLA, Engstrom, I think his name is, who has conducted a study for some 14 years, taking a peer group of Latter-day Saints, a peer group of the other population, and reached a conclusion that because of the degree to which we observe the Word of Wisdom, Mormons have a life expectancy of from 8 to 11 years longer. Now, who in the world wouldn't give almost anything for 8 to 10 years of life? I have here with me right now a statement from the Los Angeles Times on this very fact. The study conducted by UCLA tracked the morality rates and health practices of nearly 10,000 California high priests and their wives for 14 years. As a follow-up to research Enstrom published in 1989, the study confirms that the healthiest active Mormons have a life expectancy that is 8 to 11 years longer than that of the general white population in the U.S., close quote.
Based on those figures, my wife will outlive me by 67 years.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Neither would I. We'll be right back. Don't go away. We're back with President Gordon B. Hinckley of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and we go to St. George, Utah. Hello.
Hi. This is a question for President Hinckley. Excuse me.
Sure.
Number one, I'd like to say it's good to see you in good health. And two, I have a question. What would your counsel be for us of the church regarding this President Clinton issue?
Well, counsel to whom, sir?
To President Hinckley.
I mean, I know, but counsel the people in the church, you mean?
Yes.
Okay, what should you say to your parishioners?
Let the established procedures run their course. Wait for the Star report. Wait for Congress to act. We don't condemn until there has been some...
He's admitted to.
...thing that he has admitted that we're disappointed in. Seriously so. But let's let the regular processes of the law run their course. Then we can take a position.
Many churches have where atonement.
Yes.
The Catholics, you can gather and ask for forgiveness.
Yes, we do.
Can an adulterer stay in the church by admitting it?
Oh, yes, there are various penalties, but yes, we're not a harsh people in that sense. We're a very kindly, forgiving people. We really are. Our responsibility is to save people. Ours is a gospel of salvation. Ours is a gospel to lift people, to lift the world, to help people.
What do those huge temples mean, though?
Those huge temples?
Everyone knows them.
Those huge temples are monuments, if you please, to our belief in the immortality of the human soul.
You will go on after death?
Yes, of course, I believe that.
And those buildings are a symbol of that?
Yes, and they become an expression of that, yes. Baptism for the dead, for those who are beyond the veil. The Lord said, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. He didn't exempt anyone. Lots of wonderful people have lived and died without that opportunity. Paul said, what shall they do who are baptized for the dead if the dead rise not at all? Why are they then baptized for the dead? It is a scriptural doctrine.
How's the Tabernacle Choir doing?
The Tabernacle Choir is doing just wonderfully.
One of the great singing groups of all time.
Oh, they're marvelous.
Atheist love.
National treasure.
We go to Redford, Idaho. Hello.
Hi. I was just wondering if I could ask a question.
Sure.
On whether or not they discriminate against, like, non-LDS people, like for Rick's College or, like, for BYU?
No.
Oh, you want to go to BYU. Do you have to be a Mormon?
No. No, you don't.
Do you have many non-Mormons?
Quite a few, yes. Yes. We have non-Mormons there. We have non-Mormons at Rick's. We have non-Mormons.
Rick's is
another school that we have. Yes, there's no discrimination in that.
Are you happy with the way the sports program at Brigham Young has developed?
Yes, I hope we have a better football season this year.
But you've had some very good basketball teams.
We've had very good basketball teams in the past. Not so much recently. Yeah. We've had good football teams, and I hope we have a good team this year.
Do you have a Salt Lake City of Europe? By that I mean a center city in Europe, a center city in South America.
No, but we have what we call area offices across the world. We have them in Tokyo, in Hong Kong, in Manila, in Sydney.
What place aren't you in that you want to go in?
No place that I know of today.
You're in Moscow.
We go in the front door. We go in legally.
You're in China.
We go in with the public officials knowing what we're doing. We don't try any subterfuge.
But you proselytize the faith, though, right?
Yes, we do.
You want people to come to you.
Our job is to make bad men good and good men better.
We'll be back with a pretty good man, the president of the Mormons, Gordon B. Hinckley, our remaining moments after this. We're back, Barry, Vermont, for President Hinckley. Hello.
Yeah, since we're getting into the 21st century, President Hinckley, what is the chance that women may hold a priesthood in the Mormon Church?
Well, they don't hold the priesthood at the present time. It would take another revelation to bring that about. I don't anticipate it. The women of the church are not complaining about it. They have their own organization, a very strong organization. 4 million plus members. I don't know of another women's organization in the world which does so much for women as does that this church has. They're happy. They sit on boards that are of governance in the church. I don't hear any complaint about it. There are a few.
Do you know
people.
Why they can't be priests?
Well, only that the Lord has not designated that they will be.
And that's the same position as the Pope.
Same principle, yes. Same principle. I think so, yes.
So a revelation could come to you, or it could come to the Pope, the next Pope.
That's what it would take. That's exactly what it would take.
And everyone has seen all around America and the world your elders.
Yes.
These are the young men who go out on missions.
Right.
My wife's brother returns from one.
Yes,
this
he's
Friday.
Been a very good missionary.
Brett was good, huh?
I checked on him. He's a very good missionary.
Brett Engelman.
Yes.
Yeah, he's Elder
Engelman. He gets released on the 11th.
Released?
Right.
And he answers to Dale Murphy, who's
right.
going to go in the Hall of
exactly.
Fame next year.
Exactly.
He stayed active in the church, Dale.
Oh,
right?
Very busy.
Now, what are the elders in their black suits and worn-out shoes? Sounds like a song. What do they do?
They do missionary work. They call on people.
At a young age?
Yes. 19 years of age. I've had 5 grandchildren on missions now at one time. And they've been scattered across the world.
What I saw a letter he wrote recently to his sister saying that his life has changed totally through this experience. He's quite a football star, and he's going to go back to athletics.
Yeah, that's
but
what happens.
That he'll never. What does it do for them?
Look, here are 57,000 missionaries, most of them young men, sent out into the world at a time when they're most likely to be thinking of themselves,
mm-hmm.
interrupting their schooling, to go at their own expense to teach the gospel of peace across the earth. What greater force for good in all the world could you have than an army like that? What does it do for them? Builds self-confidence, builds faith, builds interest in people, builds a great concern for the poor and the needy of the earth. They learn languages. They work in
all
humanitarian
over the world, right?
work. Yes.
Women go too?
Yes, some do.
What? We only have about a minute and a half. What is the role in a society of the leader of a sect?
The leader?
What's your role? You're the leader of a major religion.
Yes, sir.
What's your role?
My role is to declare doctrine. My role is to stand as an example before the people. My role is to be a voice in defense of the truth. My role is to stand as a conservator of those values which are important in our civilization and our society. My role is to lead people.
And if you ever stray or lose that role, the effect is monumental, right?
It is monumental. It would be monumental, and it would deserve to be monumental.
Is resisting temptation hard?
No.
Not hard?
No. Self-discipline. What does the proverb say? It is easier, it is more difficult to control the spirit than to rule over a city. Self-discipline is not easy. It requires effort. It requires strength. It requires thought. It requires prayer sometimes, maybe.
And people of responsibility should have more of it.
Absolutely.
Because
they're examples before others. Sure.
This has been a wonderful
Gary, hour. Larry, it's been wonderful to be with you.
My pleasure.
Thank you ever so much.
Our guest has been President Gordon B. Hinckley, President of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Prophet. I'm Larry King in Los Angeles. Up next, The World Today with Jim Murray and more on McGuire. Don't go away. Tomorrow night on Larry King Live, the pressure on President Clinton grows as Congress prepares to receive Ken Starr's report on Wednesday. We'll be joined by Republican Senator John Ashcroft, plus an exclusive with prominent Republican strategist Ralph Reed, his first interview since the president's speech on the Lewinsky matter. And we'll be joined by former White House Press Secretary D.D. Myers. And then on Thursday, outspoken Connecticut Senator Joseph Lieberman. This week on Larry King Live.